Well, that's presumptuous. If someone says that to you, what they're saying is that you're making an unwarranted assumption. Unwarranted assumptions lie at the heart of a second class of informal fallacies called fallacies of presumption. As with the last lecture, our goal here will be to learn how to identify and explain how the fallacies are committed. So let's go ahead and look at the first fallacy. The fallacy of hasty generalization is in some ways similar to the fallacy of composition. However, whereas the fallacy of composition concerns part-whole or member-group relationships, hasty generalizations occur when somebody forms a generalization based on a sample size that's either too small or unrepresentative or both. The presumption, then, is that the sample is sufficient to support the generalization. So here's an example. My friend went back to college after 10 years, and she's really not into the party scene. College students are much more responsible today than when I was a student. The analysis here should focus on the fact that the arguer relies on a sample that's too small, specifically a sample of one, and also the sample is of a non-traditional student, and so isn't really representative of college students in general. The second fallacy is kind of the flip side of this. It's the fallacy of sweeping generalization. With sweeping generalization, somebody takes a general principle and applies it to an inappropriate case. The presumption, then, is that the general principle is applicable. So, to identify the fallacy, we should be able to state what the general principle is and be able to explain why it is that the general principle does not apply. So, for example, it has been reported that a 3-year-old shot his older brother in the leg. He should spend time in jail to learn his lesson. In the analysis, you'd say something along the lines of, the arguer commits the fallacy of sweeping generalization by applying the principle that people who shoot others should spend time in jail to a 3-year-old. But of course, this principle really is only valid for individuals who are morally responsible for their actions. 3-year-old children are not. Next, we have the fallacy of bifurcation. Remember that with bifurcation, somebody is saying that there are a certain number of options that are available to us, but they're overlooking certain other options. The presumption, then, is that the person has covered all of their bases. To evaluate this, you should be able to state what the options are that aren't being considered. So, for example, my blender didn't stop working because of a tripped circuit breaker, and it's not because of a power outage, as the power is on in the rest of the house. So it must be because of a ghost. The presumption here is that the only options are a tripped circuit breaker, a power outage, or a ghost. But of course, the arguer here is overlooking the possibility that something is wrong with the blender. That should be included, then, in the analysis. Next, we have the fallacy of begging the question. Remember that to beg the question is to assume as true what it is that you are trying to prove. So you're already presuming the truth of what it is that you're trying to establish. The way to identify begging the question is to notice that the premises really don't say anything beyond what is already stated in the conclusion. The argument seems convincing, but on reflection, you realize that there's really no evidence that's been presented in the premises. So when we evaluate this, you should be able to state in what way the conclusion is contained in the premises. Or you should be able to state how the truth of a premise depends on the truth of a conclusion. So those who deny the truth of Buddhism are mistaken because they fail to recognize its truth. You would say, well, this argument begs the question, because the only reason that's given for why denying Buddhism is mistaken is that Buddhism is a true doctrine. But really, that's just saying the same thing. What's needed is real evidence for the truth of Buddhism. Related to begging the question is question-begging epithet. Recall that with question-begging epithet, somebody is using a term to do all the work for them. The presumption here is that the epithet is sufficient to support the conclusion. When we evaluate question-begging epithet, we should be able to state what the epithet is and how it doesn't provide sufficient evidence for the claim being made. For example, the United States should not have universal health care because that's socialism. In the analysis, you would say something like, the argument commits the fallacy of question-begging epithet. The term socialism is used to say why we shouldn't have universal health care without saying anything about why having a socialist program is undesirable, or even in what sense universal health care is socialist. Next, we have complex question. Identifying complex question is rather straightforward because it's the only example that's actually in the form of a question. To evaluate complex question, be able to say what it is that the question is assuming and why that's a problem. For example, have you flunked philosophy again? The question here is complex because no matter whether the person being addressed answers yes or no, it is assumed that she has previously flunked philosophy, which may or may not be the case. The next fallacy is special pleading. The presumption here is that the cases being judged are different when in fact they aren't. Special pleading often employs question-begging epithets, but for it to additionally be special pleading, the arguer needs to be judging two similar cases differently. So, the Turks invaded our country during the Middle Ages to spread their false religious doctrines. In invading their country, we can be consoled with the knowledge that we are bringing them our true religion. Of course, what makes this special pleading is that the person is justifying the invasion by his own country while critiquing the invasion of the Turks. But in fact, both involve the imposition of the invader's religious beliefs on an unwilling population. The next fallacy is false analogy. Remember that an analogical argument is based on a comparison between two things. The presumption with a false analogy is that the similarity between the two things compared is sufficient to support the conclusion being drawn. To evaluate it then, you should be able to explain how the similarities between the two things aren't sufficient to justify the conclusion. So, birds and dogs both live on land, they feed their young, and they are highly intelligent animals. Thus, just as birds lay eggs, so do dogs. In the analysis, you'd say, well, none of the similarities being drawn between birds and dogs is relevant to the property of being an egg layer. The next fallacy is false cause. False cause requires that somebody be making a causal claim. We're going to be studying causal claims in depth in Chapter 5. For our purposes here, what is sufficient is to be able to identify when somebody makes a causal claim and why the claim doesn't seem sufficiently supported by the evidence. For example, after watching TV for 8 straight hours, Jim became physically ill and spent the next 2 days in bed. This shows the danger of too much TV watching. The arguer here is claiming that watching TV for such a long period of time made the person physically ill. In the analysis, you'd say, well, the argument commits the fallacy of false cause. Sure, watching too much TV can be harmful, but simply noting that Jim watched TV for 8 straight hours and then saying that he became ill and spent 2 days in bed really isn't sufficient to support a causal claim that one caused the other. There could just be a correlation there. The next fallacy, slippery slope, also involves a causal claim. However, where false cause makes a claim about some causal event that has occurred or is occurring, slippery slope fallacies occur when you make a claim about the future. The presumption being made is that if one event occurs, then some other event will occur, and then some other event will occur, and then we're going to end up with some sort of disaster. But there really isn't sufficient support given for that kind of hypothetical causal reasoning. For example, you really shouldn't drink Pepsi. The sugar creates a craving for more pleasure, which could easily lead to a desire for marijuana and ultimately harder drugs like meth. Well, obviously, this is a slippery slope. There's no reason to think that the pleasure centers of the brain triggered by a sugar high will lead people to crave using other drugs like marijuana or meth. Finally, we have the teleological fallacy. Remember that the teleological fallacy makes an unwarranted claim about meaning underlying an event. Very often, this fallacy also involves a causal claim. Sometimes the claim is fallacious, sometimes it isn't. So just because you see a causal claim being made doesn't mean it's going to necessarily be false cause. If the more central claim has to do with meaning, then you should go with teleological fallacy. Example: Margaret burned down her house while smoking in bed, but she escaped without injury. She then rightly took it as a sign that she should become an anti-smoking advocate. In the analysis, you would say, both the speaker and Margaret commit the teleological fallacy, by assuming that there's meaning behind the fact that she escaped the fire unharmed. There's really no more reason to believe this than the claim that the event was meaningless. Having gone through each of the examples in this section, I presume that you are now well prepared to go to the exercise set.